The purpose of this video is to provide general information and education about the care of a critically ill child. It is in no way a substitute for the independent decision-making and judgment by a qualified healthcare professional. The information contained in this video should not be used to make a diagnosis or to overrule the advice of a qualified healthcare provider, nor should it be used to provide advice for emergency medical treatment. Introduction to Burn Care by Dr. Robert Sheridan. Please note that in this video, we will be following the guidelines used at Shriners Hospitals for Children, Boston. Some of this information may need to be modified based on the equipment, guidelines, and practices in place in your institution.
Hello, my name is Rob Sheridan, and I work in the burn unit at the Shriners Hospital in Boston. What I'd like to talk about is the history of burn care briefly, a little bit about the epidemiology, something about how burn care is organized at the patient level and at the system level, a little bit about the role of burn care in disasters, and then finally long-term outcomes.
History of burn care.
I'd like to very briefly talk about some important aspects of history of burn care. This is a woman, Zora Jancikovic, who ran a burn unit in Eastern Europe in the 60s and 70s, and she wrote a very influential paper in the 1970 issue of the Journal of Trauma in which she described early excision of burns in her experience. The traditional treatment of burns at that time was simply supporting the natural history being progressive colonization, infection of eschar, and then liquefaction and separation, leaving a bed of granulating tissue which was then grafted, that process taking 2 to 6 weeks typically. She was one of the early people who recognized that this process could be dramatically shortened by acknowledging when a wound is full thickness, cutting away the dead tissue, and immediately grafting the resulting wound. And she did this in a series of patients in her unit and reported in the 1970 issue of the Journal of Trauma, and demonstrated that she had a very short hospital stays, much happier patients, much better long-term functional outcomes, people that really started the early excision trend in burn care. And this is one of my favorite quotes from her. The patients in the wards presented the usual clinical picture of large exposed burn wounds covered by broken down eschars with infected granulating areas on anemic, exhausted, and frightened individuals. And this really is true. And if you have the opportunity to visit units where traditional burn care is provided, supporting the natural history of progressive liquefaction and separation, this really is the rule. And spare patients that experience is a really a good thing.
Epidemiology.
Briefly, a little bit about the epidemiology of burns in the pediatric group. It's a lot of scalds, a lot of cooking and bathing related incidents, and this is true worldwide. As people get into the young working age range, they tend to be injured in more industrial accidents, high voltage injuries, flame injuries. And once again, as people get older, they tend to be injured more with scalding and kitchen accidents. An unfortunate reality is that the patients who are more likely to have bad long-term sequela of their injuries are those in the developing world where it's more difficult to survive with those sequela. In other words, a disability related to a burn injury is better tolerated in someone in a developed environment than it is in an undeveloped environment. And so it's very important, I think, to try to optimize the functional outcome of patients who have suffered injuries so that they can do well and be happy and productive in the world in which they find themselves.
Burn care organization.
How is burn care organized? At the patient level, burn care initially comprises a resuscitation over the first day or two, followed by an initial excision and biologic closure of the wounds over the first week or so, followed by definitive wound closure and addressing small areas of high functional importance like the face and hands over the succeeding 1 to 5 weeks, followed by long-term reconstruction and reintegration, which can be a very brief experience or can last many years depending on the severity of the injury. On the system level, it's optimal if the people, equipment, and resources that are required to take care of the patients are concentrated, so the expertise stays well rehearsed. And in the United States, there are burn units that are dedicated to that purpose. In the developing world, there are programs like in Nicaragua and Honduras, where some very sophisticated programs have been developed to optimize care in a central location for their patients. Unfortunately, that's not the reality in most parts of the world. In most parts of the world, burn patients are taken care of in the local hospital nearest to where they're injured. Another benefit of developing a centralized cadre of people skilled with wound and burn care is in addressing natural and man-made disasters. Very frequently, patients suffering injuries in earthquakes and terrorist scenarios and bombing incidents have injuries that are either burns or very similar to burns, big soft tissue injuries, and having that expertise in the medical system is very, very useful. It's also true in wartime, unfortunately, with blast and fragment injuries being so common, and this skill set that you evolve in a burn unit from the nursing side and the physician side is very useful to caring for those patients as well.
Long-term outcome.
Very briefly, as regards to long-term outcomes, what I'd say is there's a large body of data. The data gets more robust every year that says that patients with burns, if they're managed in an organized way, will do very well over the long haul. They'll become happy taxpayers, and it does require attention to get the wounds excised and closed as early as possible to avoid the septic morbidity. And it does require that the patients have access to reconstructive and rehabilitative services, ideally very early, to optimize their functional outcomes so they can become independent and become quickly employable.
That concludes our video on Introduction to Burn Care. Thank you. Please help us improve the content by providing us with some feedback. What did or didn't you like about this video? Was the content too simple, just right, or too difficult? Was the length too short, just right, or too long? Any additional comments? You can either click the Start a New Discussion button and type in feedback or send us an email at openpediatrics@children's.harvard.edu. Note, feedback is not required to complete this activity in the guided learning pathway.